Every Houdini learner must be deep down a geometry spreadsheet appreciator. Today we will have a look at this data that is shown in there. So buckle up, we talk attributes. But we cannot talk about attributes without taking a moment to understand how Houdini deals with geometry. Some setups, for example particle systems, are exclusively driven by attributes. So understanding this powerful concept and how everything works together will make your life way easier as you dive deeper into procedural workflows. Inside Houdini, geometry is divided into four base elements it contains of: points, edges, primitives, and vertices. They exist in 3D space, and each of them can carry data. For example, position, x, y, and a z coordinate, or in Houdini terms, at P. This handle is always used when referring to a position. The easiest form of this position data is a point. Points are Houdini's most fundamental elements, but, and this is key, point by itself doesn't create visible geometry, it's just a position in space. Create yourself a second point and connect them, voila, you have an edge. Edges are simply lines between two points, but in Houdini, edges don't really exist as standalone entities. They are a result of how primitives connect points. Talking about primitives, primitives are the actual shape you see. The most common type is a polygon made of multiple points connected by edges. But primitives can also be curves, NURBS surfaces, or even volumes. Each primitive is like a container that references points via vertices. Vertices often confuse beginners because they sound like points, but they are not the same. A vertex is the connection between a point and a primitive. So when a primitive references a point, it does so through a vertex. Think of vertices as the glue between points and the shapes they form. That means multiple vertices can reference the same point, allowing for more control over things like texture coordinates or normals in a per primitive corner basis. As it was not enough to assign data to all of these elements, we can also assign data to the geometry on a global level. This is called the details. So, to sum it up, points are positions and data holders. Vertices are the bridge between points and shapes. Edges are the connections between points. And primitives are the shapes built from all of the above. Once you understand this structure, you start to see how powerful Houdini's geometry system really is. Because now you're not just moving shapes around, you're thinking in data. Let's have a look how attributes work in practice. So I have this nice little UFO living in my scene somewhere in 3D space. And in order to judge its attributes, we need to access the geometry spreadsheet, which we appended down here in our interface episode. In case you don't have it, you can just edit as a new pane under the inspectors and edit geometry spreadsheet wherever you want. I prefer to have it down here, and as I just said, you can see the geometry and all its points in 3D space. Let's turn on the visualization for all the points, and once we select points, we should be able to see them in here. So we selected a bunch of them, and yeah, the more and more attributes you assign to your geometry, they will show up here and divided in those respective areas that we just tackled. The points, vertices, primitives, and details. You can think of attributes like your geometry's passport. Everywhere it visited, it will get a stamp or a new attribute, and it will carry it on to the next node it visits. For some countries, you might need a visa. So speaking in this analogy, also some nodes require certain attributes to work. Over time, your geometry will collect lots and lots of attributes. So every once in a while, It's a good idea to get a new, clean and fresh passport, or in other words, that you delete all the attributes in order for Houdini to compile your geometry or your node stream faster. So let's assign a new attribute to it, attribute create. In this node, you basically can choose the class the attribute should be assigned to. So again, we have our respective areas in here of the geometry that we can access. Let's say we want to assign it to primitives. And as a second option, you get the type. You can have different kind of types. Let's do a quick refresh of attribute types. Integers or whole numbers, floats, numbers with a decimal point, vectors, a list of numbers for directions or distances, a string, basically a piece of text, or arrays, which can be a list of items from all of the above. I think that covers everything that we will need for now. Okay, in this case, let's say we want to pick a vector attribute because I want to assign a color, and the color is divided into R, G, and B. So three values, that's why we settle on type vector attribute. In order for Houdini to understand that we want to assign a color and not like a position data or a direction to the geometry, we need to give it a descriptive name. And color is understood natively by Houdini, and it's called color diffuse, so CD in short. You can see once I assigned it and I highlighted, the entire geometry turns black because our values are all 0, and 000 in the RGB refers to black. If I put in a 1 for the red, you see we will have a red geometry. If I do for the green or for the blue 1 or for all 3 a 1, then it turns white. This might be a bit cryptic, that's why there is a better node, a color node. Once I plug this in, this is a bit more streamlined because I can choose just a primitive class, and I have this nice little color picker in here. We can select a nice purple color. Once we come down here in the geometry spreadsheet and we go to our primitives, you see those three new values for red, green, and blue assigned to our geometry. But now our entire UFO turned purple, and I just want actually the bottom half of it to get this color. The rest should be plain white. So how do we do this? We need to leverage another concept of Houdini, which is called groups. So let's make some room in here, and we will assign a group. Groups are also basically just attributes that assign a value of 0 or 1 to your geometry. Let's create this new group. We call it bottom, and we will assign it also to the primitives. Per default, you see everything is selected, but we don't want this, so we turn it off and we say we want to select geometry according to some bounding regions. Here we have different kind of options. Some will just work with certain parts of the geometry, but for now let's settle on the bounding box. In here you can see we now got this little red box, and we can just grab it and extend it to all of the sides in order to just select this part of the geometry. We could even push it down to really just select the bottom half of the UFO like this. Perfect. So, and once we come again to our primitives, we see we have the primitive number and assigned group to it, which is called bottom with the value of 1, which indicates that this part of the geometry is now inside the group. Or by clicking here, I reverse the sorting of the table, and you see all the rest of the geometry has the value of 0 assigned to it. Once I come back to my color node now, and I choose inside this group dropdown our bottom group, you see just the bottom elements of the UFO have our purple assigned to it. That's perfect, exactly what I wanted. Another cool concept of attributes is that you can inherit them from one geometry to another one. Let me show you what I mean by this. I want this UFO also to fly a little bit up in the air. Right now it sits on our ground, so I could either transform it, or to have later on more control about it, I can create a point and I can copy my UFO to that point. So let's add a point and we put it up in space. Maybe even more up in space, like 5 units. So my point now lives up here and my UFO down here. So I will go in and say copy to points like this. Select my point here, and now my UFO is in the top here. And what I mean by inheriting certain attributes is that we can assign attributes to this point and they will be understood by the copy to points node and being applied to our UFO. For example, I will say attribute create and I wire it in here. I want to assign it to the point group and I want to make it a float attribute and I will call it pscale. This is also another attribute that is like natively understood by Houdini, and I will insert you a little overview in here, like the most commonly used attributes in Houdini and also the ones that are natively understood by Houdini. Okay, so we have our pscale attribute and currently it's 0. So let's give it like 0.5. And you will see that the UFO is scaling accordingly. If I hold the middle mouse button, I get this nice little parameter ladder and I can just go left and right and you see you can seamlessly scale the UFO while doing this. So let's say I want to have it like a little bit smaller like this, and in this stream of this point we go to the point geometry spreadsheet. We highlight it, you see there's the pscale value assigned to this point, which is then understood by the copy to points node, and the UFO is scaled accordingly. So you can basically remember pscale like the point scale or particle scale. It will tell every renderer how big a certain point is in your scene. Okay, to conclude this section, I want to show you one last aspect of working with attributes, and in certain instances it's very handy to split up your geometry according on some attributes. So let's say to prepare my geometry for the rendering, I want to render this bottom purple section in a different kind of material than the rest of my geometry. So in order to do that, I could either assign you groups in the rendering section, or I will split up my geometry in here and assign different materials to each section later on in the rendering. So let's do this. Let's assign a split node. We come in here, and in this kind of group section, I could of course just select my bottom group again, which is this one, or I could also address an attribute, and I do this by adding the letter add, and now I will put CD and I want to select everything that is below 0.5, and you see we basically cut it off all the white parts again. And once we assign a null object on this side, we can say purple, and we can assign another null object on the other side and say white in here. So what we did here is basically we said, okay, look at the color attribute and look everywhere where the value of this color attribute inside our primitives is below 0.5. We could even pick like 0.1, so it will look in all three things at the same time and split the geometry at this part, which is super handy. Imagine you applied a noise texture or something like this to your geometry and you just want to select the bright parts, and so now you know how to address your attributes in your node stream and you can build a lot of complexity from here. To sum it up, attributes can be freely assigned, inherited, promoted to different levels and transferred between geometries, and even be deleted again. In a later Vex and Vops tutorial, we will dive deeper into this topic and learn how to manipulate attributes on another level. If you don't want to miss out on it, make sure to subscribe to the channel and consider hitting the little bell icon. It would mean a lot to me. So, in the next tutorial, we will have a look how to model this little procedural UFO. See you there.